This is an even better way to start.
Fire, please.
Before I get a big dribble.
Thank you. 29 bucks. The wine was better than the mama.
That's a Tom Waits song, if you didn't know that.
the one before that was an Edgar Meyer song called Unfolding. So now you're all caught up. Ah, this is going to be fun. You are a lovely bunch of people. I didn't say that yet. We're going to play a song now that I wrote this in Scotland. I do a TV show over there called The Transatlantic Sessions. And I've been lucky enough to do that 6 different seasons, and we've got about 250 songs filmed in the can over there. We want to turn them loose on PBS and see who, if we can drive away the Celtic women. I'm sorry. All the Celtic women fans in the audience. Oops, I think I touched the nerve. We're going to play this one for you. This is a song I wrote outside of a little town called Aberfeldy, which is outside of another town called Pitlochry, which is outside of another town called Glasgow. So I think you probably know that one. But I had a lot of fun down there, and I love the place, and I wrote this song there.
Thank you.
back into the good old American song back for you for this one, and it's one that happened a little bit before the folk scare that happened back in the 60s. It's a rock and roll number. You know, we're going to try to find out why you're not hearing the fiddle like you should.
I know.
It's important to us. This is Christian Settlemyer playing the violin. Make sure you hear it, because I can't hear it. I like it, and I want to hear it. So we're going to work on it for a second and find out why. There it is.
There it is.
And that made a difference. There we go.
This is the most applause Christian has ever gotten.
It's true. It kind of felt like it was just slammed by a brick wall of applause. That was really nice. Thank you. I'm drinking some Scottish tea, actually.
Yeah, I bet.
In the mood.
We'll talk about that later. That Scottish tea thing. It's going to get better. I can just tell you that right now. And it's probably going to happen on this song. So, what was I saying? Oh, song bag. Yes. So we're dipping back into the good old American song bag. And this actually happened. I was wrong. This happened after the folk scare. This is a one of my favorite bluegrass writers, Jimi Hendrix. All right, I'm ready.
Good.
Bluegrass experience, boys. That's right. What happens?
Yeah.
one that Jordan liked this one. that was called, what was it called? Senior's Lament. Still got it. My doctor told me if you think you have Alzheimer's, you don't have it. I'm going with that. And, okay, the next one we're going to do, this is off the new record, and the title of the new record is What If. And What If is just, there's no punctuation after What If, there's no question mark or yeah, that kind of stuff. It's just What If, like What If a dobro player had a horn section. So, that's what we got. So this song is called What If, and we're going to play it for you right now. And Jamel Mitchell back here on the saxophone, everybody. Jamel helped me write this song. He wrote the, there are some beautiful lines in this song, and he wrote them. I didn't. I keep tuning because I've been told people in Texas care. And they can tell if you're out of tune, so I'm making sure I'm in tune. The next close enough for bluegrass right there. Okay. So we're gonna play this song for you, I think. Right about now. Thank you. you. That's one of those songs that, you know, you hope ends up in a movie or something. So you can go to the mailbox and pull out a big check. On the guitar from Bridgewater, Virginia, would you welcome Mr. Mike Seal. This whole band is amazing. This whole, everybody in this band, yeah. All these guys are just, I'm so lucky to get to play with them every night. I just don't know, I don't know how to act, man. So I'm just standing here just shaking all the time. I'm getting over it. A lot of therapy, though. A lot of therapy. Mr. Daniel Kimbrough on the bass. We have more degrees than a thermometer up here on this stage. We're going to play this song now. This is one that I started about the time Game of Thrones was going to come back on. You know, we had about 6 months before that was going to come back on, and I thought, well, you know, I'm going to write a song. Maybe this will make it into Game of Thrones. And it was getting weird. It was a very strange song, and it wasn't strange enough yet. So I went over to Mike's. I came to my house and we made it really weird. It's a song. It's called Battle Stick, and Battle Stick can be anything. You know, it can be that guitar in the Battle Stick for sure, or a golf club or a fishing pole. You can fly a fisherman in here. That's definitely a Battle Stick. And or a baseball bat, or it can be anything. A switch. Ooh, I used to get the battle stick all the time. So we started writing this song, and it got plenty weird, and now we're going to play it for you, and it's on the new record too. And I won't be hopping the written new record anymore. I'll stop. Sorry. You. He does the merch, so I ask him if it's okay.
But I think it is.
Yeah, don't, you don't need to buy the record, it's fine. Actually, it's better if you do. Also, public service announcement, probably don't try and dance to this song.
You'll fall down. It's not in like a waltz time or anything like that when you start dancing. But you know what we were playing? It made me think we were playing a casino one time up in Wisconsin or somewhere like that. And every song we played, it didn't matter what, there was this one couple that danced the same dance to every song. And we were just trying to figure out how they did it. I guess it all ends up, you know, in four somehow. You know, 16, you know. It's all one, actually, yeah. Just put one foot in front of the other and you'll make it to the end. You may fall on your partner once or twice, but get up, dust yourself off, and keep on getting. So, here we go. Battle Stick, six beats in the front. Got it?
Thank you.
Yes. Oh, that's weird.
You thought it was weird. It's really weird to us.
But now we're gonna dig back into the old song bag one more time for you here. And this is one that was by that wonderful bluegrass band, A Weather Report. One of my favorites. I was actually introduced to them by a fellow in Lexington, Kentucky, many years ago. I was playing with a fellow named J.D. Crow in New South. Had a really good bluegrass band. And Tony Rice and Ricky Skaggs. And, I'm not really supposed to drop names, sorry. My friend Paul McCartney said it's not good to drop names. Well, so we're sitting on his porch and he played me this record, Heavy Weather. That day. Heavy Weather and another record, a Chick Corea record, Light as a Feather.
Yeah.
And I thought I knew a lot about music. You know, I was doing pretty good. I was playing with this guy, J.D. Crow. Pretty cool. And I knew everything. But no. Blew my head completely up all that day. And I've never been the same since. So this is the stuff that rolls around in my head all the time. You know, when I stand out on stage playing with Alison Krauss, I'd be thinking about this. And I don't know how that went together, but it did. And I think if I hadn't been so strange, I think we maybe not. I wouldn't have sounded like that in her band either. It was just a thing I needed to get through, need to work through. And that's kind of how that 219 thing came up. We were doing a tour, and I was feeling a bit like Groundhog Day every day. And I went in the back of the bus and started listening to Tom Waits records, and that one jumped out at me. I thought, that would be exciting to just drop that one in the middle of Allison's set, wouldn't it? And she wouldn't do it. She wouldn't. That's the sound I heard when I asked her. Like, it just breaking glass. That's what I heard. And so we didn't do that. We waited till now. So this is a good time to play this song too. This is a beautiful song. It was written by Wayne Shorter and Joe Zawinul, and from the band Weather Report. And I've cut a few of Weather Report songs, but I'm going to cut every song on Weather Report, Heavy Weather, before I'm done. It's just too good. So, but this is called A Remark You Made, featuring Daniel Kimbrough.
Yeah.
No pressure. Thank you. For you, that's been good for me. I've had this song for a long time, and been playing it a lot, and it's been recorded a lot. It's been on a lot of records, and we like that, actually, because mailbox, you know, and it's been really good because every time something really bad happens to the house, a washer or dryer or a hot water heater or something blows up, you go out to the mailbox and. Hot water heater. Now, this song's called "We Hide and Seek," and it was on my record originally. Then it made it to an Alison Krauss record, and then it was on the live Alison Krauss in Union Station record, and then it was on a Cracker Barrel record, for God's sake. And then in a couple of other compilation kind of things, it's made it too. So I thought, well, this is great, man. And then one night, a guy came up to me and said, "You guys, I want you guys to do that song, Come and Go." And I went, "I don't think we do a song called Come and Go, sir." And he said, "Yeah, you do." And I said, "Well, how's it go?" And he said, "Well, you play it for a long time, then he plays it for a long time. He plays it for a long time, then you play it again, and then you quit." And I said, "That's everything we do. You have to give me a better, more hint than that." And he said, "Well, it's called Come and Go." And I said, "Okay, all right, well, we're going to play this anyway." And so we decided to change the name of the song and put it on more records. And then we can get bigger appliances. Here's one we love called Come and Go.
Thank you.
Come and go.
Ouch.
That's hard.
Something you've got, baby.
We're going to do this song now as I wrote this song in Telluride, Colorado a few years ago. And it's a fast number. And I'll tell you what, the whole thing came from, I was watching Little Feet play. I was there, I was done. I was finished playing for the weekend and I was just sitting in what we call the poser pit. And it's like about where you are. And but this chair's all lined up across in front of the stage, and then there's a big old fence, and then there's all those people. And so we're sitting down there, and I'm tired, man. I'm tired. And but right next to me is my friend Bela Fleck is sitting here, and Sam Bush is sitting here. Edgar Meyer's out there, Margaret Connor's out there. We're all sitting there. We've been worked to the bone, and we're watching Little Feet play. And so we're just, you know. And then all of a sudden, this beret starts coming down the line, and it's got these little things that look like popcorn, but they're a little darker brown. And everybody was just pulling one out and eating it and passing it to the next person. It came to me, and I ate one, passed it on to Sam, and he ate one, and went on down the line like that. And it came back, and I ate another one. And, you know, it just kept happening. And the lights and the colors started. You can do it again. That's what happened. I heard that noise and I started seeing really pretty lights. And Fred Packett was playing a really nice green Strat. And it was glowing. It was like a better green than anything I've ever seen in Ireland. Thailand, anywhere. And Paul Barrera was playing a banana yellow Strat. And it was just great. One time, Fred turned into a dragon and ate Paul. And regurgitated him back up, and then Paul played another solo. This stuff kept going on and kept eating these things, and by the end, we were just going. Just kind of staring at it, and they were pointing at us. They were pointing at us on the stage, and we couldn't say anything at that point. And after their set was over, they came down and sat down with us, and they ate some too. And so I finally made my way out of there and went back to my condo that night. And I had the most amazing dream. It was a Technicolor dream. And it was about Fred Flintstone. And, Fred was in his car, and Barney Rubble was pushing the car, and his feet were on fire. And it was, you know, like in the cartoon, and his feet were just, like, the most beautiful red, and with this like sun yellow coming off. And Fred was not alone up in the passenger compartment. Fred was sitting there with Charlie Parker. And they were talking about jazz music, which would not be created for another million years. But they were already hip to it and had figured it all out. And they were talking, and this song kept going around and I just remembered the song when I woke up the next morning. This dream, all this stuff came to me later, but the songs, I wrote the song down and we're gonna play it now. It's called Cave Bop. And it's fast. And, we'll do this one for Fred and Barney and Charlie. Thank you. Nice talking to you. Here's a song I wrote a few years ago. That was called The Last Wild Moor. After I've been listening to a lot of Leuven Brothers. My God, those guys were great. Have you ever read, there's a book you should read. It's called Satan is Real. It's a quick read. But it was written by Charlie Leuven, and it's all about the travels of the Leuven Brothers, and it's amazing. It's in Charlie's words. It's just nuts. Charlie was always beating the crap out of his throat. Guess that's what made Ira sing so high. This is called Push Too Far. It's a song I wrote to get into this fiddle contest. It was actually a note contest. You had to have 25 notes in the first measure of your song to enter. So I wrote the first part, no problem. I hit a stump and I called my friend Russ Barenberg, this great guitar player. Yeah. He really helped me write the rest of it.
Yeah.
And Russ came over and we wrote a part, and it was pretty good. And he had some cookies and milk and then he left. The next day, he came over and we wrote another part. It was getting kind of hard to play the song yet. But he had some cookies and milk and went home. On Wednesday, he came over and it was so hard we couldn't play it anymore. So we both had whiskey and stayed. This is the only part, this is the part, the song I remember. This is Tuesday, really late Tuesday night sometime. It's called Push Too Far, and we lost the contest. Okay. There's two more songs. Here's one. We're going back into the back end of the song bag stuff again. This one's by a young fellow from Kentucky whose name is Chick Corea. He was Bill Monroe's Uncle Penn's best friend's grandson. His name was Chick Penn. I sure hope that doesn't get back to him. But it's possible, I guess. So we'll play. This is called Spain. This is a nice little number. You ready?
Yes.
Oh,
awesome bluegrass band tonight. My God. Well, you know, this is just the stuff that floats around in our heads, and you got to get that stuff out.
Oh, yeah.
Get a log jam like that going on in there, something bad is going to happen. So we're going to play this one more song for you. This is called Who's Your Uncle? And but first, I would like to thank everybody, all these guys up here on stage. We're going to miss along the saxophone. This is Mr. Back here on the drums from New Orleans, Louisiana, is Mr. Doug Beloit. This is called Who's Your Uncle. Thanks so much for coming to see us tonight. I love playing with Kessler. It's wonderful. It's the second time we played here, and it's twice as good this time. And Rob Stokes for handling the sound so deftly this evening. It's good. Good job, Rob. Thank you. Thank you for coming. We're going to play this song.
Whoa, here we go.
Give me one more song.
It would be very cruel of us to send you home all hopped up like that.
And they'll say, well, yes, you know, I really enjoyed myself and I really appreciate the speed that you're driving. So everybody will get home safe. Everything will be all right. That's the way we want it. So we'll play one more song. This is called Sir Ally B. This is I wrote this for my friend Ally Bain over there in Scotland, over in the Shetlands. And Shetlands! It's not Scottish, it's crap. But we'll play this one for you. Thanks so much for coming out tonight. Enjoy playing for you. Happy Father's Day. Thank you. stuff.